You are listening to Daily Bread Devotions with Father Eustace Siame, a Salesian of Don Bosco. Your word, Lord, is a lamp for my steps. Stay tuned.
This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
It is Sunday, the 8th of November, 2020. 32nd Sunday in ordinary time. And coming to the 32nd Sunday in ordinary time, knowing very well that we have only 34 Sundays in ordinary time, we are coming to the end of the liturgical year. We only have 2 Sundays. So this Sunday and next Sunday, since we are coming to the end of the liturgical year, the church wants us to focus on vigilance. How we can remain vigilant, how we can be people who are prepared at any time for the coming of our Lord in our lives. And that coming happens every time we die. But how prepared are we to face that day? This Sunday and next Sunday, we'll focus on that. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, graciously keep from us all adversity, so that, unhindered in mind and body alike, we may pursue in freedom of heart the things that are yours. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Our first reading will be taken by Sister Teresa Mutale, a Daily Bread member and a Precious Blood sister working in Nairobi, Kenya.
Wisdom is found by those who seek her. A reading from the Book of Wisdom. Wisdom chapter 6, verse 12 to 16. Wisdom is radiant and unfading, and she is easily discerned by those who love her, and is found by those who seek her. She hastens to make herself known to those who desire her. He who rises early to seek her will have no difficulty, for he will find her sitting at his gates. To fix one's thought on her is perfect understanding, and he who is vigilant on her account will soon be free from care, because she goes about seeking those worthy of her, and she graciously appears to them in their paths, and meets them in every thought. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading will be taken by Sheila Gondwe, a Daily Bread member from Lilongwe, Malawi.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. We would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, shall not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself would descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first, then we who are alive, who are left, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel passage will be taken by Father Anthony Eyuk, a Capuchin missionary working in Kampala, Uganda.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Matthew 25, verses from 1 to 13. At that time, Jesus told his disciples this parable. The kingdom of heaven shall be compared to 10 maidens who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. For when the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, "Behold, the bridegroom, come out to meet him." Then all those maidens rose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "Perhaps there will not be enough for us and for you. Go rather to the dealers and buy for yourselves." And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other maidens came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly, I say to you, I do not know you. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Let us begin with the gospel passage of today. Here is the context. Jesus is in Jerusalem, the last week of his ministry. He is actually 2 days away from being arrested. He contemplates, he realizes that he is going to leave behind men and women who are going to carry on this ministry. But how prepared are they to make sure that this ministry continues? He gives a series of parables. The parable that he gives today is only found in Matthew. And he talks about the foolish and wise virgins. The foolish virgins are the Pharisees and scribes who are taking their own time, who seem to ignore the fact that the Lord is already among them, and they start doing anything else and everything else that they want to do. The wise virgins are those believers who accept Christianity and take it seriously and start working on it to an extent of making sure that they are ready at any time to meet the Lord. And so he gives this parable. That is a summary of what this parable is all about. The 10 virgins. But it is difficult for us to understand if we are not attuned to the customary way in which the weddings used to be held in those years. The marriage ceremony would take about a week. And in that week, there would be a period of preparation. The first part is made up of the bridegroom going to the family of the bride and taking the bride to his own house. As he goes to that family, he will find ladies waiting for his coming. Those ladies were supposed to be virgins. They were supposed to be unmarried. Those were girls who were prepared that one day they would get somebody to marry them. But they were supposed to be pure, virgins. In this regard, uncontaminated. Very good people. And they were there waiting. And when the bridegroom would come, they would go, follow the bridegroom to go and start the celebration that would take a week or so. So this is the context. The bridegroom comes when they don't expect it, because he would come anytime. It's not like there would be a program to say, okay, at this moment the bridegroom will come, or at this hour he will come. No. In Israel, the bridegroom would not give the timetable to the in-laws to say, I'm coming at this time. No, he would come at any time. That's why Jesus uses that parable to make them understand. It's unlike our weddings, when we know very well that the mass is supposed to start at this time, when we know very well that the bridegroom is supposed to leave at this time, so that by 11 they are in the church for mass, and the bride should be done with the cosmetics and everything at this hour, and they go in for marriage. But it was not the same at that time. Nothing was prearranged. But they had to be always ready, knowing at any time the bridegroom would come to take the bride. The bride was supposed to be ready at any time. That is the background against which Jesus uses this parable. To tell us we are the bride of Christ. We are the maidens of Christ. We are bought by the blood of Christ and made pure by that blood of Christ on the cross. And what is needed for us is to make sure that we keep the oil, enough oil for us to meet the bridegroom. And this is where the point is, keeping enough oil. These people had little oil left. That little oil left should have been enough for them to get in. No. Jesus doesn't want Christians of the minimum. He doesn't want people who have little oil. He wants you to have enough oil. That's it. And having enough oil means being prepared. Being people, men and women, who are planning ahead. A true Christian is a great planner. A true Christian is one you can rely on, because these people do things in advance. A true Christian is one, when you ask the person to do something for you, this person will do that something in time. And we want to reach that stage. I'm trying to help many people in our Daily Bread family who are learning how to read on Daily Bread, to say, listen, I do things ahead. I'm a student. And being a student, I do things far ahead. And so if you decide to read for Daily Bread, know that you are bracing for pre-planning for something. You read a month before your day. And many do not know how to keep up with this kind of planning. We have people who just want to live from hand to mouth. You tell them you are expected to hand in this audio recording on the 20th, and you give them on the 15th, and they wait until 20th for them to send the audio. And this is where we have to learn how to do things. This is where we have to learn to even take it so seriously that if I'm given on the 15th, I make sure on that day I send the audio. I pre-arrange something. You know, you get a lot of peace inside you when you know you have things done way ahead. And Jesus wants to train his followers that, listen, you have to learn to do things way ahead. You have to learn to make sure things are in place much in advance. And when we have people like this, we will have our nations developing. People fail to plan for tomorrow. People fail to plan for day after tomorrow. People are giving birth and they are not even thinking of what their great-grandchildren will find once they are gone. There is lack of planning there. I am living quite all right. I am working quite all right. But I'm just thinking of now. What will my children find? What will my grandchildren find? I should live for my grandchildren. Not just for myself. Not just for my family. No, I learn to plan, to see, to eat, that once I am gone, they will find something in place. That is what a wise virgin does. That is what a wise maiden does. Planning ahead. Planning ahead is a call we have, and we are not going to relax at all. We are going to be people who have things in place in such a way that I'm not worried. Whatever will catch up with me, I will not be caught unawares. I will be found ready. And a person who is ever ready, a person who plans things well in advance, will never have heart problems. Will never have issues with his or our own health. This is what we want to learn to do. This is what we want to work on in our lives. We have to learn to be the wise virgins. We have to learn to be the five wise maidens who prepared way in advance. And what is this preparedness we are talking about? It's wisdom. The wisdom that is mentioned in the first reading of today. Men and women who are wise, and wisdom here is that ability to know what to do and how to do it at a specified moment. We are told wisdom is a she. Wisdom is radiant and unfading, and she is easily discerned by those who love her and is found by those who seek her. She is wise. To fix one's thoughts on her is perfect understanding. And he who is vigilant on her account will soon be free from care, because she goes about seeking those worthy of her, and she graciously appears to them on their paths and meets them in every thought. The vigilance is mentioned here. Once you have wisdom, you are vigilant. Once you have wisdom, you know how to behave even with your own spouse. Once you have had this woman called wisdom, you will not be messing around when it comes to your family. Once you have had this woman called wisdom, you will be punctual at your workplace. Once you have her, this woman called wisdom, you will not allow yourself to get involved in corruption. Once you have wisdom in your life, you will not be a drunkard. No, there will be a sense of dignity in your life. There will be something about you that people are going to admire, because you are a person very much attuned to the signs of the times. You are a person very much ready to do what you are asked to do with all diligence and with all passion. We want that wisdom to be in our lives. We want when people look at us, they see a sense of dignity in us. We want when people ask us to do something, they know it will be done. Because we are Christians. Because we are among the five wise maidens. I want this to be in our lives. I want this to be so much in us that we don't have to be asked whether we did something that we were asked to do. No, there is self-motion, there is self-push from somebody who has the wisdom that comes from God, from somebody who has married wisdom, Sophia. And that Sophia must be in us. And that wisdom must be in us. When people look at us, they just see how relaxed we are, despite the many things that we have to attend to. But we are so relaxed. And we are able to manage the tensions of life. We are able to manage the pressures of life without having any health issues attached to panic. We are not going to be the foolish virgins. No, we won't be caught unawares. Nothing will catch us unawares, not even death. Not even death is able to catch a Christian unawares. No, we see a sense of serenity, a sense of peace in the faces of those who die in the Lord. I remember the face of my own mom. Despite having suffered from cancer, despite the pains that she went through in bearing with cancer, when the time came for her to say bye, she released herself. She freed herself. And I could see in that coffin, not somebody dead, but somebody who has met God. She had such sense of peace. She was one of the wise maidens. A woman who prayed. A woman who was constantly alert to God's biddings. And this is the alertness we are supposed to have in our lives. We don't want anything to catch us by surprise. No. St. Paul explaining to the Thessalonians who are worried about the end times tells them, listen, it will be very nice. It is a moment we have to look forward to regarding those who have fallen asleep and those of us who are still alive. There will be a moment when those who have fallen asleep will be the first ones to come out. And then the rest of us are going to meet them in the sky. What a glorious imagery. But the reason why Paul is saying this, he wants the Thessalonians who were misled to be guided well. It is not up to you to know when these things are going to happen. No, please. You keep doing what you are supposed to be doing. Be prepared. The Thessalonians started, you know, lazing around. The Thessalonians thought the end times were coming the following day or the following week. As many people might be deceived because of COVID-19, and others may be thinking this is the end of the world. The world is coming to an end. This is just too much. And many may be preaching like that. And this makes people to stop doing what they are supposed to be doing. And they start just relaxing and saying, anyway, what's the use of even planning for tomorrow? There may not be tomorrow after all. And the Thessalonians had that thinking. They thought there would be no tomorrow. But Paul tells them, please continue working. That time will come, but it's not in our hands right now. Please keep doing what you're supposed to be doing. Don't lazy around. No. Be people who are planning for tomorrow and day after tomorrow and the year after and 10 years from now, 100 years from now. Even if you may be having cancer, plan for 50 years from now. Plan for 100 years from now because you want to remain immortal even after you are gone. Do things, as I keep saying, live your life as if you are going to die tomorrow, but work as if you will never die. Because you are thinking of the generation to come and saying, what will they find when they come here on earth? Will they find something more than they expect because I worked hard to prepare this earth for the future generation? Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed Sunday to you.
Thanks be to God.
This is my daily bread.
Your bed.